Okay. Yo, what up? My name's Keith Shockley. Producer, I guess. I did a lot of groups. A lot of older groups. Don't get it twisted. But Public Enemy, the LL Cool J, Ice Cube, Slick Rick, Madonna, Janet, Jackson. Don't ask her last name. I did a lot of rock, Public Enemy, you know, cause that, Bomb Squad, you know. I forget a lot of things that I've done, man. I've done Ziggy Marley and the whole crew, Bell Biv DeVoe. I did with Bobby Brown, you know, a couple of things, you know, try to keep it moving. We ain't let nobody do our beats. it just evolved as a production team. As of me, my brother Hank Shockley, my cousin Eric Sadler, and Chuck D. And what happened, how we started to get into production, this was, you know, back in the early days, it was dealing with being signed to Def Jam. They had a lot of artists that needed tracks. So we was never, me and my brother and my cousin Eric was never in the group, Public Enemy. We just did all the music for them. So we decided, like, we got to eat too. While they was on the road, we just started doing beats for, like, a bunch of, you know, up-and-coming artists. Like, I did one for 783, which had DJ Muggs. And, you know, I showed Muggs how to do beats and stuff like that back then. And, you know, Muggs is phenomenal, doing a lot of rock mashup groups right now. It was at Cypress Hill. He started 783, then went to Cypress Hill, and then now he's doing a lot of rock and mashup stuff. So, and at the time we had to come up with a name that was gonna distinguish us as a production crew. So instead of using crew, we came up with the name Bomb Squad, which everybody took from Terror Squad, the Flipmo Squad, the EPMD had a squad, the squad, Hit Squad, Hit Squad. So we were the originators of that. So, you know, and after that, you know, we just started producing a lot of groups, doing a lot of remixes. You know, Quiet is Kept, we were the first one to start the $20,000 remix. We're the reason the sampling laws was put in place. Not in any other group, the Bomb Squad was the reason why sampling laws were put into place. Where we used to sample snatches from a lot of different records. Like a bass line from one record, a snare from another record, a guitar riff from another record. We never did full loops. So everybody now is doing full loops. No, we sampled from parts of records. Whether we ran from a rock record to an opera record, to a country western record, to a soul record, R&B, blues, anything we thought was hot, New Orleans jazz, soul, anything we thought was hot, and we used to mash them like collages. And one of the biggest things we was known for, all our records was noisy, because we felt that rap was noise. Rap was noise, so we figured out a way how to make noise very musical. So it wasn't just, you know, random noise. Everything had its place. Everything had its place inside the tracks. Man, we had a thing that was developed called Moot Court. It was all about the sampling laws. So every sampling law that's in place was because of all the records that the Bomb Squad has done. Nobody else. So, yeah, they caught us after a while. You know, we had a lot of sample claims. I remember we did Night of Living Bassheads, and there was a sample claim, a sample. It was 2.5 pages long, a sample claim, like 2 columns. So that's a lot of samples. Oh, it'll be like 3 seconds. At that time, they were trying to get whatever, because there was no laws at the time. So whatever they felt that was right, but then a lot of stuff was thrown out because it was too short. So therefore, it had to be like more than 4 bars. So if you take it more than four bars, now you get hit with the sampling fees and everything. But what happened was people started to copyright sound. So like the drum track to impeach the president, which was by the Honey Drippers, this guy Aaron Fuchs owned the copyrights to that, plus the sound of it. So if you hear a snare that sounds like impeach the president, he gets sample rights for that. If you can recreate the sound, then you have to prove it in court that you recreated. If you can't prove it in court. Oh, hell yeah. I mean, all that the record label picked up. A lot of cats used to sell their publishing rights to publishing companies, and they would sue. So that was the biggest thing. Like George Clinton sold his rights to Bridgeport Music. So Bridgeport Music figured out how to make money off of the sample and of suing people. They were suing motherfuckers left and right. So that's how they do it. But basically, that was broken down within the record label and the actual net gain. That didn't affect your mechanical royalties. So, you know, as mechanical, they don't. The production game, I thought, went haywire after that. It's like, I mean, everything evolved because of the technology involved. The producing game became very sample-heavy and sample-heavy oriented because of the fact that the equipment started to sample more time. So now it took its own form. But nowadays, I see the sound has went back to the 80s when we used to use the 808. So now everybody's using that sound now. It's like you got a mixture of that, which is the 808 sound is more popular in the commercial side of music, and the sample drum sound is not as now. I mean, that's all marketing. Sometimes the producer was better than the artist as time changed. So that's why I think the producer became more the forefront, and they figured out like, well, I'm doing all the hot tracks, I must be the hot one. Like Pharrell, you know, Pharrell is, if you got Pharrell on every artist that's making a record, or that's mostly that's out, so now the producer becomes the game. Back then, every artist had their own crew that did their beat. Now, everybody go around looking for beats from producers. I mean, it's an up and down to that, but everything has its place. I mean, it had to go through that because a lot of producers was taking unknown crappy artists and making them something by not just doing the beat, but actually teaching them how to work a song, how to write a song, how to work the mic inside the studio. So that's when the producer became the music became more producer driven. The producer had the musical sense and knew the musical arrangement. The artist would just come in, here's the song. I mean, it was always producer driven even back in the 60s. When you had, like, going into Motown, you had the Norman Whitfield, Hollandoza Holland, Ashford and Simpson. They was all songwriters and producers. You know, Smokey Robinson started out as a songwriter for Motown, then started producing all stuff with the Miracles. So they were all producer driven, but they wasn't put in the forefront like it is now. You wouldn't know who they were. You would.